All right, welcome back, everyone. We have our next match just about set up. Of course, that is going to be Panda Gaming, which is our team that qualified from China, versus Splice, which is the team that got second place in EU. So this is going to be an exciting series. Splice has, of course, Swapsy, Botar, and Fabs on it. You know, three really well-known players that are constantly showing up. You know, Fabs, of course, has won two BlizzCons so far.
Yeah, they are the reigning champions from last year. They sort of breezed through BlizzCon 2015. They're here once again to try to get that victory. Obviously, a tremendous team, did an incredible job at the European regionals, but I think they have a tough opponent ahead of them, this Chinese team. They've been practicing a lot here. A lot of the players are surprised at just how well they are doing, and I'm excited for this next game to see how they perform.
Yeah, and they have three people on this team. It's just Swapsy, Botar, and Fabio. So what's key to note here is that the Koreans only have three members in their team, and this team does too, but this team is actually so confident in themselves. They thought that they were going to just take this match easily when I was talking to one of them earlier. So that's true confidence that they can swap between the classes that they need to, whereas the Koreans weren't able to.
Now, of course, Splice is the team that's also known as Toxic Youth over the last few years, but, you know, Splice being another one of those great WoW Gaming sponsors that, you know, decides to pick up some teams. And of course, that is Swapsy that is on your screen. You know, he's really a well-known player over in EU, constantly seeing his name up on the high up on the ladder or at tournament results. So these are one of those kind of someone that you might overlook sometimes when you see flashy names and those like top streaming players and stuff, but they show up year after year after year in these tournaments and they're doing so well.
Well, a big part of that, I feel like, is how much preparation these guys put into it. You can see here Swapsy, the anti-mage. He is not a big fan of the mage class. He basically does everything he can to shut that class down. and a lot of the time, like, Lock Shaman teams think that they are disadvantaged against Rogue Mage teams, and Rogue Mage teams think they're disadvantaged against Lock Shaman teams. So there is that little bit of player bias, but Swapsy, out of everyone, I think hates the mage the most.
Yeah, from talking to him, he was just saying, like, Lock Shaman at BlizzCon, and then he fights Mage Rogue, and he's saying, oh, Mage Rogue, it's crowd control, I can't get my burst off, while the Mage Rogue is saying, hey, you guys are dealing damage to our entire team at once, we're always low, this is no fun for us either. So there's always that back-and-forth battle between the Lock Shaman teams and the Mage Rogue teams.
So Splice is going to be playing against Panda Gaming, which they have the team with four players this time, and that's going to be Dark Arcanio, and we have Saji, Doe, and PCAT. So they have a pretty good roster, and this is one of the teams that I think, you know, a lot of the North American and EU players kind of count them out, you know, because sometimes the Chinese teams don't do that great at BlizzCon, you know, when they show up. But when I was watching the practice, they were taking rounds off of just about every team that I saw them fight.
Yeah, they were surprising a lot of that teams here, and this is, of course, Dark Arcanio on your team. Last year, or actually at the 2014 BlizzCon, I believe he wasn't able to come due to a visa issue, but now he's finally here. This guy consistently qualifies in the Chinese realms in order to make it to BlizzCon. You can see there China's MVP, Dark Arcanio. He's always bringing a team, different roster every single time, but very consistent on that Warlock, and also a very good multi-classer, which is something a lot of people don't know about him.
Yeah, they were saying that their qualifier was actually extremely tough just due to the how many teams that were in it, you know, and it being only one team going through from China. That's tough. I mean, sometimes, you know, with the North American regionals where, you know, a couple teams can make it through, you know, you kind of have that cushion. As long as you make it into the top four, you kind of almost guaranteed to make it at that point. You know, even if you lose one, you can win one. But having to beat everyone and win it just to make it to BlizzCon is really tough for the team of Panda Gaming. All right, Elliot, who do you think is going to win this matchup?
I would have to say Splice. I just think Splice is such a well-prepared team. When you talk about guys that really do a good job doing their research, practicing different compositions, these guys always play to win. They put a lot of time and effort into making sure they have the best shot possible, and I just feel like they're prepared for every single team here.
All right, now, Rodney, who do you think is going to win?
I'm on the opposite side of that. I want Panda Gaming to win. I want to see this dark horse, this underdog. These guys have came out here from China. They have never won a BlizzCon before. They want to bring it home, and I'm really excited to see what they can pull.
Yeah, I'm really excited to see Panda Gaming also. I'm actually not sure who's going to win this one, only because I would really want Panda Gaming to win. However, I know Splice is just an incredible team, so if I could call it as tied 3-3, I would. but Rich, who do you think is going to win this one?
Well, I'm definitely not going to call it a tie. I'm actually going to make a prediction, Jared. But I think Splice will ultimately take it. But I got to talk to Fabs a little bit before he actually sat down, plugged in his keyboard, and got ready for this match. And he said one thing to note is that he is not sure what this team is going to play. They have so many comps, so he is a little bit scared of that, but ultimately confident he will take the match. Back to you, Jared.
All right, thank you very much, Rich. You know, that's getting some 2-1 Splice over Panda Gaming so far in our predictions. So we know that Splice is a great team, but of course Panda Gaming kind of don't know what they're going to run. Maybe they've been practicing comps against these players and are ready to throw a curveball at them and show up with a comp that nobody's expecting.
We're just going to have to wait and see what these guys decide to play. They are sort of the dark horse, like you were saying. No one really knows what to expect out of them. In war games, they've been practicing and preparing a lot of different options, so we'll have to see what they decide to play and, of course, what Splice decides to answer with.
Yeah, and I'm excited to see what they've brought because they have quite a few classes that people aren't expecting. I saw them warming up a Feral Druid earlier. They had a Death Knight. They have a Rogue, a Shadow Priest. They have a ton of stuff that I haven't really seen too much of at this tournament, so I'm excited to just see what they pull out in the first game.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's going to be exciting. As you can see, there is the trophy that these players are playing for, and of course, the prize money and the bragging rights. And there we go. There is Splice Gaming. They are getting ready to start this off, the three-man team, not having that fourth roster member to swap to in case they need to kind of swap up the comps. But here we go. And as you can see, on top left is going to be Panda Gaming. And this is an interesting comp. We really haven't seen much out of it. You know, a Resto Druid showing up to play. And of course, then Splice playing that comp that they did so well with in the EU Regionals.
Yeah, this looks to be their bread and butter composition. Once again, playing that Assassination Rogue, that Retribution Paladin, and that Restoration Druid. They have a lot of upfront damage. Their cooldowns are really scary, with that Avenging Wrath coming up from Swapsy and the Vendetta coming up from Fabs.
We're actually seeing Cursive, I think it's called Fragility, the 20% health reduction talent from Dark Arcanio, and we are not opposed to seeing this composition. We've seen the Enhanced Demo Law come out before. It has a lot of defensive utility, but we actually have the Resto Druid there. Actually, Dote taking a lot of damage early on here. There's the Bloodlust coming from him as well. Swapsy taking a ton of damage as well on that Paladin. It's crazy how much damage he's taking right in the opener. There's the healing cooldown coming out from Botar, so we can get some heals out on this Swapsy. He does top him off. There's tons of damage going out onto Dark Archon and Doe at the same time. The Cyclone goes out onto Dark Archon to solve some healing there. Really great play. If they can get some damage going out, another Cyclone. I wonder what they're going to do with that. If they can get Cyclone onto Soggy, they can get a kill here. And they're just doing tons of damage to this enemy team. There's the Kidney Shot onto Dark Archon. He's taking a ton of damage right in the opener here.
Yeah, absolutely. There's a lot of pressure going back and forth right now. Splice is in a commanding position, though. Botar throwing out that Iron Bark to prevent some of that incoming damage. But the split strategy coming up from Splice looks to be too much for Panda Gaming at this particular time. Dark Archon, of course, on that Demonology Warlock, getting dangerously low right now, down to 20% HP, catches a big heal. Into that Kidney Shot, though, Fab's going to be running over, just using that Kidney Shot to CC up Dark Archon on his casting circle, but he's going to be able to finally get out of that spam with those fears. Doe, though, taking quite a bit of damage. He does have Bloodlust available. Right now, Panda Gaming is completely on the back foot. Bloodlust coming out from Dao. They're trying to turn around the pressure the best they can at the moment, but it looks like Splice is completely fine. The Axe Toss going out onto Swapsy, the Bash going out onto Botar. Nice count, or nice cross CC coming out from Panda Gaming right now. Doubt still a little bit low, trying to reconnect onto Swapsy. Swapsy, though, still has his bubble available, so I don't know if this is the best trade for them. Swapsy getting down to around 20% HP, the Bash going out onto Dao right now. Saji, though, still has that Iron Bark available if he needs it. Right now, Doe needs to be very careful, though, that he doesn't overextend.
Yeah, and Swapsy still has his bubble. They really haven't had any pressure on Splice the entire game. Panda Gaming sitting low the entire time. There's a Vendetta coming out from Fabs onto Doe. He has a defensive cooldown, but I don't think it's going to be enough here. He's taking so much damage. There's an Iron Bark on him. He's still taking a ton of damage. There's a Fear coming out onto the Fabs, but it's not going to be enough. He needs to get back to his target whenever he can. Doe actually getting topped off here from Saji. I don't know how he's getting that healing off, but he's able to get him back to half. Tons of damage coming out of Swapsy. He might have to proc his bubble for once here. They finally got some pressure, but there's a Kidney Shot on the Doe to peel that off a bit. Swapsy just has the defensives, though, still. He still has bubble, and Dark Archon and Doja have been sitting at 50% the entire match here.
Yeah, Swapsy can feel very confident when he pushes in and does these sort of damage exchanges because of the fact that he does have that bubble. It's going to proc unless he gets interrupted. Dao, though, taking quite a bit of damage, down to 30% HP. Swapsy actually having his bubble proc, the Bloodlust coming up from Doe and Dark Archon, just doing so much incredible damage. We've seen this composition have such incredible bursts, so Swapsy's going to have to be very careful of that. The offensive Cyclone going out onto Botar. If they can get any more CC onto Saji, the Hodge goes out, actually immediately gets out of that with that adaptation trinket choice, so he's not going to be CC'd up for a little bit, but the next CC chain onto him will be full.
And I'm getting worried for Splice here. They've gotten Dark Arcan low, they've gotten Dolo, but they haven't gotten their kill yet. No bubble on Swapsy now, so if they get, they can get in trouble soon. But Dark Arcan gets Kidney Shot. He does have his wall available, and Saji's just able to keep them alive through all this, even though they've been at half the whole game. He's starting to go a little in, but he does have his Iron Bark still available. No adaptation, so if he gets CC'd, he could be in trouble here. And again, Doe just sitting at half. They have so much pressure on them throughout the entire game. No wings available from Swapsy for a while, but the Vendetta is now available for Fobs.
Yeah, that's going to be their win condition. Immediately, Fabs uses that Vendetta onto Dark Archon. The defensive cooldown's coming out from him, trying to prevent some of that incoming damage, with Doe and Dark Archon taking so much damage. Saji almost completely right now. This is not looking good for Panda Gaming. Splice in a commanding position. Swapsy needs to make sure that he's not getting too aggressive, though. Botar does have those defensive cooldowns. Doe, though, down to 10% HP. Is he going to be able to hold on? The Legion Commander comes down from Dark Archon, trying to prevent some of that incoming damage. Swapsy and Fabs going to be playing a little bit careful because of that. But right now, Panda Gaming is in so much trouble. Botar pushing in the full bash on the Saji. Adaptation gets him out of that immediately, but Dark Archon's still so low. Saji just has no more mana left. He has nothing left in the tank. The damage coming out from Fabs as well as Swapsy is just too high right now. I don't know how he's going to be able to survive.
Yeah, and Saji doesn't have any mana. His Kidney Shot onto Dark Archon. He actually has a defensive. They both have defensives. He's casting Healing Touch in the corner. He has nothing left. He's somehow keeping his team alive. They just haven't gotten any pressure in so long. They need to get on the offensive. They need to get that Bloodlust back up and get some burst up, but they just haven't gotten that. Bubble's coming up in 35. Wings is coming up soon. Doom is coming soon for Dark Archon and Doe. Doesn't matter the target. They're both sitting low. Saji needs to go for a drink, if anything, right here to come back in this.
Yeah, Swapsy has his wings up, though. Fab's going to be having that Vendetta up in 17 seconds. Those are huge cooldowns. Doe trying to use that Bloodlust. He wants to counter pressure a little bit the best they can, but they just really can't get too much going right now. Botar's mana is getting a little bit low as well. We're not even in dampening, and both healers running on fumes at this point. The full Hodge out onto Saji, the bash going out onto Doe. Now Dark Archon's going to be in a lot of trouble. Vendetta just comes up for Fabs. Is he going to use it? Immediately uses that Vendetta. How is Saji going to be able to heal through this damage? Doe at 50% HP, Dark Archon at around 70% HP. That Iron Bark paying dividends right now coming out from Saji, preventing some of that damage and powering his healing, but that's the last cooldown he has left.
There's just nothing remaining. Doe at low, Dark Archon getting low. They don't have bubble from Swapsy yet, and it's just going to be downhill from here. Dark Archon sitting at, he just has cooldowns on cooldowns. He has the wall up now. There's a Kidney Shot onto Doe, sitting at 30% HP. He's taking so much damage. I don't know how Saji is healing through any of this. He doesn't have mana for the past 35 seconds, and it's just he's getting lower and lower, but somehow Saji is keeping him alive. I'm thinking he'll go down soon, but Doe is just kiting away like a madman.
Yeah, the Fel Lord doing a lot of work there. Fabs reconnecting onto Doe, though. Saji literally has nothing left. Doe down to 5% HP. He's going to go down in that Garrote silence, and Splice is going to take game number one here with so much pressure. They're running that composition. We haven't really seen it play too much in tournaments, or specifically this tournament, but they're coming back, they're showing that it still works, and they're able to beat Panda Gaming in this first game and go up 1-0 in the series.
Yeah, and this is the comp they did so well with at their regional tournament, the Retro. They're bringing it back out, and they're doing so well with it. Not a surprise from them, and we're seeing the enhanced immunology of Warlock come out again, but it doesn't seem as strong as any of the other teams that we've seen run it so far, so I think they need to pick up their burst because they didn't have those windows where they were just dropping the other team to 10%. They've really had only one time that whole match, so I'm looking for that more in the future from them.
Yeah, one of the things I did really like out of the team of Panda Gaming is normally if you are an enhanced shaman and you want to score a kill, you will bloodlust, of course, your demonology warlock just so you can get faster casts out. But when Saji was falling behind in healing, I actually saw him bloodlust the healer too. So he was able to pump out really fast regrowths. However, regrowths are quite expensive, and it actually cost him in the end because he was able to keep the team alive but wasn't very mana conservative, and you know that's basically why I think Panda Gaming really lost that game, was Saji running out of mana.
I just feel like it's the Restoration Druid is the weak point on that team. If they had that Holy Pally composition, the Holy Pally, the Enhancement Shaman, the Demonology Warlock, I think that's really where the power comes from. I don't know if Druid really has the healing to deal with the Assassination Rogue. Vendetta just comes up so often. Winx comes up as well, and it's really hard for Druids with the amount of throughput they have. They don't have the amount of CC required to support a Druid. Usually, Restoration Druids, they need a Rogue or they need a Mage to really peel up the enemy team so they're not taking quite as much damage.
Yeah, strange comp overall coming out there. I mean, that's why the Holy Paladin is played. They have the Avenging Crusader. They have the bop. They have the bubble. They have ways to prevent that rogue damage, which was killer in the end for them. And also, mana was a huge issue so early on. We haven't seen that from the Paladins here, but Druids and Shamans have been going really fast in these games, so maybe not the best choices for this tournament.
All right, Rich, how do you think that last round went?
Well, Jared, one of the things that Fab said before going into this, I did mention it, was that he was afraid that Panda might actually break out some interesting stuff that they weren't expecting. And we saw Dark Archon do just that. He was using Curse of Fragility, but ultimately, Splice was able to hold it down, and a big part of that is because Botar is able to handle any situation. Botar is definitely the pillar of this team. Jared, back to you.
All right, thank you very much, Rich. Yeah, we'll have to see a different swap. One of the things I did see during that game was Fabs was using Vendetta pretty much on cooldown, like you guys were calling out, just because he knows that it's such an immense amount of pressure when that goes off, and they don't have that Blessing of Protection like we saw the teams able to fall back on before. And there we go. Okay, Tolvaron Arena is going to be the pick from Panda Gaming. Do you think this shows that they're going to switch their comps?
I think so, yeah. Actually, I'm not exactly sure. I think this map's going to be a little bit better. Of course, Swapsy and Fabs are going to have to overextend just a little bit more on that red and rogue if they decide to play the exact same thing. So I think this bigger map's going to give them a little bit more wide open space for Dark Archon as well as Saji to get out those Cyclones, get out those Spheres, and get out the burst that they need.
Yeah, it really comes down to if Fabs is scared of having to go across the entire map, because if they feel like that's the case, then they should swap comps to something more caster-based. That should have at least one caster to counteract this long map that we're going to be running across. But the real question to me is, does Panda Gaming have a composition that can take advantage of Tolvaron? Because picking that says, all right, we have some kind of caster composition. We either have a mage, a shadow priest. We're going to maybe swap out the enhancement shaman for something else. They need to do something here. They can't run with that same composition.
Yeah, it'll be interesting to see what they're going to pick out of this because, you know, this is one of the teams that we don't know very much about. You know, we know that they have a large number of comps available. You know, they could have a secret comp that we're overlooking for this setup, but we'll have to see. And of course, Splice, I don't know if they're going to change. You know, they had a lot of success. We'll have to see. And there we go. We're going to have the Rhett Paladin, of course, Swapsy playing that. And of course, Botar on the Restoration Druid and Fobs on the Assassination Rogue. You know, and the scary part will be is if Fobs does get caught out in the middle or Swapsy gets caught out in the middle. You know, these are large pillars. Hopefully the team of Panda Gaming is really practiced on this map so they know that they can capitalize on the melee having to move across the map.
Yeah, I think this is a really intelligent choice for Splice. The Retribution Paladin and the Assassination Rogue, like we've been talking about, very durable, doing a lot of consistent damage. And I think the only thing that can really stop them is that Holy Paladin. The enemy team, Panda Gaming, these guys don't have the ability to run a Holy Paladin. I just don't see them besting Splice. Maybe on this bigger map, they'll have a little bit more of an opportunity to kite around, but I think it's going to be difficult for them either way.
And they are continuing to run that Enhancement Demonology Restoration Druid, so it's going to be the same matchup. I'm wondering what Saji's going to do about his mana, because that was the biggest issue last game. He ran out of mana immediately in that matchup, so he needs to figure out a solution for that. Maybe go for some drinks earlier, maybe go for more Cyclones, shut them down a bit, maybe get more Fears out. He needs to do something to stop that. One thing to worry about is Swapsy on this map is a Rhett Paladin. He's going to have to try to get on his target while not dying in the center of the map to a Demonology Warlock, so he's going to have to figure out what he wants to do. If anyone can do it, though, it will be Swapsy. He has that melee veteran experience, and that's so important in these tournaments. When you're on Tolvaron Arena, it's the true test of a melee character. They need to know when to run in to go to their target and when to run back to their healer, and Swapsy is one of those guys who knows how to do it.
Now, the only talent difference in both honor talents and normal talents between Botar and Saji is running Prosperity, so he is going to have the two charges of Swiftmen, so he has that big instant heal if he needs it, and Botar is actually playing Cenarion Ward. So, you know, if you're a Resto Druid at home, those are the two different play styles that you can go when playing these comps.
Yeah, we'll have to see how Splice decides to open up in this game. I think they're going to end up doing the same thing. That split strategy seems super effective. It's hard for a Resto Druid to deal with that amount of damage. He's going to be having to cast those regrowths, like you said, but they cost a lot of mana, and if Saji's not careful, his mana's going to run out very, very quickly.
And I still love that Dark Archon is running that Curse of Fragility, 20% minus health. I think that's for when the Bloodlust happens, but I haven't seen that burst come out from them. I'm really looking for that this game. We do have players opening up on each other now. There is no cooldowns pop just yet. They're trying to get things going. There's a Cyclone immediately onto the wings of Swapsy. He's going to break out of it and go for damage onto Doe. There's a Kidney Shot in the Dark Archon. Really just splitting here, trying to shut both players down. Interesting start here.
Yeah, once again, just the exact same strategy. Swapsy, though, taking quite a bit of damage. He is pushed up quite far, positioned nice and safe with Botar as they are on the Pillar Fobs. Once again, just pushing in a little bit recklessly, but he can do that on that Rogue. He does have all those defensive cooldowns if he needs it. Vendetta out as well on the Dark Archon. Saji, he still does have that Ironbark available as well. Doe using that Bloodlust, trying to get aggressive, not able to accomplish too much. Swapsy just going to be pulling back, pushing behind the Pillar, trying to trade some damage with Doe right now, and he should be fine, but he gets down to 10% HP, actually. Going to be activating that shield. Botar trying to connect onto him, uses his defensive cooldowns, and he should be fine.
Yeah, and he's starting to get lower and lower. There's a Cyclone on him. Really good Cyclone to get him low. They need to get CC onto Botar as that expires. But no, there's a Cyclone going out onto Doe and a Hodge onto Saji. Dark Archon, the one taking damage. They've been low again this entire game. Doe dropping dangerously low already. He has not popped his shield wall. He's really confident in Saji to use that Iron Bark instead. Dark Archon getting kidney shot. Dark Archon just getting shut down constantly by Fobs. He knows to shut down the Demonology Walk. He plays one himself. He knows to stop those casts and what exactly to interrupt.
Yeah, but at the same time, Swapsy actually had his bubble proc there, so he no longer has that cooldown available. This big map ends up being good. Dark Archon yelling for the burst. Swapsy could be in a little bit of trouble right now. Botar using that Iron Bark. Swapsy, Botar pulling back, using that pillar the best they can. Fobs still just trying to get out as much pressure as possible on the Dark Archon. The kidney shot goes out. Vendetta is going to be up in 5 seconds for Fobs. They want to get aggressive with that cooldown, but Swapsy a little bit scared to push off of the pillar right now. Saji pushing in, getting that bash out onto Botar. Doesn't look like he's going to be able to follow it up with anything for the time being. Fobs getting targeted down, using that evasion as well. No evasion, no vanish. So Fobs is now a good target as well. He does have that Vendetta cooldown up, so this could be a little bit scary for Panda Gaming, but right now Panda Gaming in a really good position.
And look at Saji just taking control of the game, triple clone of the Fobs into Roots, cloning Swapsy after. He's just all over the place with crowd control. Instead of spending mana healing through stuff, he's just getting Cyclone after Cyclone. It's really helping them get pressure, really allowing Doe and Dark Archon to get damage off. They're finally getting some more pressure onto Swapsy. There's the wings coming out from him though, trying to get more pressure onto Doe and Dark Archon. They're hitting both of them consistently. It's very interesting to see that, because usually you'd think Red Rogue, they would want to connect eventually, but they're just splitting consistently, trying to shut down Dark Archon while kiting Doe around.
Yeah, if we look at the mana comparisons on both jerseys, they're relatively even right now, sitting at around 60% mana. Swapsy, though, taking quite a bit of damage. Doe now pushing in, using that Bloodlust. Blessing of Protection coming up from Swapsy. He wants to prevent some of that Bloodlust damage, but it doesn't look like he's going to be able to. Doe trying to get that off with those purges, getting a little bit unlucky there, sitting full onto Swapsy. Doe a little bit overextended right now. He's going to have to be careful to make sure Saji can actually get some heals out onto him, as he is down around 50% HP. Dark Archon still just being trained the entire game by Fabs. Fabs doing an excellent job trying to shut down that damage. Doe once again pushing in. He needs to be careful that he doesn't overextend. The offensive Cyclone coming out from Botar there onto Doe, so he's going to be a little bit low. Dark Archon as well, down to around 40% HP. He is out of line of sight. Saji just having such a hard time healing through this damage.
And Doe sitting low now, sitting at 50%. He does pop his wall. And Saji, again, in that situation where both of his teammates are just sitting so low all the time. Swapsy toe-to-toeing Doe all game and always ahead in health. And it's so easy to keep trading him down and have Doe have to run away and lose all of his pressure. So this strategy really working out for them, shutting down Dark Archon with one and shutting down Doe with the other. We have Doe still sitting at 50%, Saji getting to 30% mana now. He's just always constantly under pressure, but he's still getting the Cyclones. He's getting the bash on the Botar. He's going for a clone after. I did believe he does get interrupted though and gets the clone on the opposite side. Bad trouble coming in here for Doe now, getting kidney shot. He's sitting low. Saji needs to get over there and get some healings out.
Yeah, he absolutely does right now. Doe still a little bit low. Big heal connecting from Saji using that Iron Bark. Swapsy and Botar just making it so difficult for Dark Archon to actually get out any damage. Just line of sighting. Fabs is shutting down Dark Archon by training him. Doe, though, dipping dangerously low once again. 10% HP. The Garrote goes out as well. He's going to be using that gateway to escape for now. He's going to get topped off by Saji before he pushes back in.
And there's the Vendetta. Wings coming up in 1 second for Swapsy. Bad news for Saji here. He's not going to be able to top him off even with heals right now. Doe is taking a ton of damage from Fobs. And again, Dark Archon is actually getting some cast up, but he hasn't really done much damage. He's not doing that Demonology Warlock damage you'd expect from the other Warlocks here, and they're all just always sitting at half HP. It's incredible that Saji's able to keep them alive. There's the wings coming out, but Vendetta's already faded. Doesn't matter, maybe. Doe taking a ton of damage, full Hodge onto Saji. They're trying to connect to Doe. Doe is just running for his life. He gets bashed in the middle of the map. Fobs finally reconnects, but he's already sitting back at half. Saji doing God's work once again.
Yeah, he does, and he does have that Iron Bar coming up in around 3 seconds. That's what they're going to need to survive. The wings coming out from Swapsy, though. Swapsy getting targeted down, taking quite a bit of damage. The Bloodlust coming up from Doe as well. Swapsy now trying to get away. The Fel Lord coming out as well as that Vortex. A good little combination coming out from Panda Gaming. But Dark Archon is in a lot of trouble. Saji playing it very safe, very calm, not using that Iron Bar. He might need to use it before it's too late, though. The clone going out onto Doe, the Hodge going out onto Saji, and now Dark Archon is all alone. Luckily for Saji, he did have that adaptation available. He uses that Iron Bar in the nick of time, and that should keep Dark Archon up for now.
Yeah, and Pop is just running back and forth between both DPS, keeping Rupture up, keeping Deadly Poison up. That's why he's doing so much damage. That's why they're under so much pressure. So he's really carrying his team right now, doing a ton of damage, both sitting at half again. Vendetta back up. He's going to be able to pump out even more damage. Doe sitting low. Both players connecting. They're calling for the kill in the background. Kitty shot on a Doe. Full Hodge on the Saji. This is going to be where it's at. He's trying to run away and Ghost Wolf. He's getting some heals off, but it's not going to be enough. He actually gets a knockdown, but it's not enough. He does go down, and they will take game number 2.
One of the great plays that I saw during that game from Panda Gaming, actually, is they, and we talked about this during the regionals, we didn't see it happen yet, but we saw a Fellord dropped with a Cap Totem on top of it and an Ursul's Vortex. So they try to run out, they get stunned, they get hit by the Fellord, they try to run out again, they get pulled back in Ursul's Vortex, and they get Fellorded again. But they didn't end up winning. But, you know, they really did a great job. Fabs, like you were saying, spreading the Rupture damage is really what forced Saji to fall really far behind on that. Even though he was rolling hots on both members of his team, it still wasn't enough healing.
It just really felt like it was Splice's game to lose. They have so much damage. When they are in trouble, Swapsy and Botahar can just line of sight. Fabs can sit out there pretty confidently, shut down Dark Archon, making sure he isn't able to push in. He doesn't have a lot of mobility. He's going to be taking a lot of damage, getting interrupted. Splice, once again, doing a great job, playing it smart, playing it safe, and able to take that second game.
And Rich, how did you think that game went for Panda Gaming?
It was undeniable that Splice played very well, but you can't sleep on Saji. He looked absolutely phenomenal. I got to talk to him before the series started, and he was saying that he really looks up to people like Minpoke and Zuniaki, and he's playing amongst idols right now. But even further than that, when we get to watch him play, it is clear he is on the same caliber. He's playing like a legend, and I think he's going to be able to take a game off of Splice. Jared, back to you.
All right, thank you, Rich, for the update right there. Of course, you know, this does mean that Panda Gaming is down 0-2 right now, with Splice pretty much taking a commanding lead. I mean, both of those rounds really weren't that close. There was a couple good moments that we saw some setups. One of the things I could think that Dark Archon can do a better job with is that Curse of Fragility has a 10-second duration, so it's going to reduce their max health by 20%, so you know you can really set up that burst with it. But it has a 45-second cooldown, so it's not up very often, so you really need to pick those windows. And there was a lot of times that I saw him just tossing it out onto Swapsy without having that burst coming from Do.
Yeah, he needs to make sure that Botar doesn't have Dispel available, as well as he can just remove it immediately. So maybe throwing out a Fear, if the Fear gets Dispelled, then he can use that Curse, get full value out of it. But it does look like Panda Gaming is going to be choosing Ashamain's Fall. Rodney, do you think that this is going to give them any sort of advantage on this map?
Honestly, this sounds like a disadvantage to me. Why? Because Dalaran Sewers is the Demonology Warlock map. You bring them behind the pillar, you drop the Fellor, you drop that Vortex, that's when it becomes valuable. You get to have them stay there and actually attack Doe for once. Meanwhile, on these other maps, these large maps, they're just cutting out of it. And that's, to me, one of the biggest parts about Demonology Warlocks right now, is cutting people behind a pillar, dropping the Fellor, not allowing them to attack your team.
Yeah, really taking advantage of that zone control with that ability. Really smart. This just seems like such a hard matchup. Do you think Splice will end up locking in the same composition, or do you think they'll run something else?
I think they're going to go back to that same composition. Red Rogue is working out so well. Bob's really impressing me. He's doing so much damage, more damage than I've seen any of the rogues here do today, and it's just because of his ability to know when to swap, when to get that extra damage off onto the other target, when to go back on his main target, and he's not even dotting the other guy because he wants the CC change to sit full, because I'm really impressed with how Bob is playing.
It's like he's using all those skills that he learned on Warlock and really applying it to that Assassination Rogue. Assassination Rogue is kind of like a melee Warlock right now, Affliction Warlock. They just run around, they spread their damage, and that's one of the things that impressed me about him as well, is at the European Regionals, he did more damage than any other Assassination Rogue by far.
Now, do you see a comp swap happening for Panda Gaming, or do you think they're just going to play straight into this again?
Well, that's a crazy thing about Panda Gaming, is we have no idea what they can actually run. I'm not sure if they feel like this is their only option, if they maybe do have something else on the back burner. Last game, they did intentionally pick this comp into the Rhett Rogue Paladin coming, or Rhett Rogue Druid coming out from Splice. So you have to think that maybe this is their best shot, and they just have to go in, hope that Ashamain's Fall is going to work out a little bit better for them. Maybe a strategy change, but I'm not sure.
You know, I'm hoping Ashamain's does work out for them, but I'm hoping to also see a comp swap, because if they stay with the same composition, they're basically playing on a very similar map. Tolvaron's a huge map with a few pillars spread out. This is the same idea, and if they run the same comp, they were behind the entire game. They're both at half. Saji was doing really well healing. He looked amazing out there, but they weren't getting anything done offensively. So they do not decide to swap their comp, and I'm really disappointed.
The thing that they did swap, however, is going to be their faction. I did see, you know, by taking a look at what they have logged in right now, of course, they are going to be playing a Dwarf Shaman. for enhancement, and so that, you know, provides a little bit of a light counter to that assassination rogue with the stone form, you know, being able to stone form off the bleeds and the poisons all at the same time. And of course, then you have a night elf druid and a human warlock. So let's hope this faction change does help them a little bit, you know, because like I said before, those last two games didn't seem in the favor of Panda Gaming at all.
Yeah, Dark Archon not going to be playing that orc anymore. He's going to have the human, so he does have that additional trinket to get out of stuns and maybe let him get off that burst a little bit more. Of course, the stun durations are going to be longer, but he's going to be able to pick those key moments when he really wants the burst because of that.
You know, I like this because now the shaman can get the bleeds off and the poisons off from himself, which he was having trouble with. The warlock can break out of stuns. He was having trouble with getting kidney shot on his casting circle. The druid shadow meld into drink. They all have better options now with this faction change, but I still don't think the matchup was really in their favor. It wasn't their races that were giving them trouble. It was the matchup.
Yeah, we'll have to see how this next game plays out. Panda Gaming, of course, one game away from being knocked down to the lower bracket. Splice, of course, looking to close out this game and move forward that much closer to that top four bracket at BlizzCon.
And the rest of Druids are playing those same talents, of course. Saji is going to be playing Prosperity for the two charges, Swiftman and Cenarion Ward for Botar. So we'll have to see, you know, how these rest of Druids do. Both rest of Druids are doing a great job. Lots of offensive Cyclones, you know, pushing up for those mighty bashes.
And there's the immediate wings coming out from Swapsy. Opener with Sap onto Cyclone, into Cyclone, onto Doe, and that's a really good opener for them. There's the wall coming out from Dark Archon. He knows he has to pop his defensives early with that wings being popped. Still no Vendetta used yet, and I want to see who they're going to use that on and where they're going to put the pressure, but I don't think their strategy was bad at all. They need to swap between both, get them both low at the same time, and they're already doing that.
Yeah, Dark Archon getting swapped to now, the Vendetta going out onto him. Doe taking quite a bit of damage as well. The Bloodlust comes out. He's trying to counter pressure. Fab's taking quite a bit of damage using that Vanish. He needs to get away. Botar connecting those heals onto him. Still has that Ironbark available if he needs it. Saji already using that Ironbark in relation because of the Vendetta. Decided to trade out that cooldown. The offensive clone coming out from Botar onto Doe, keeping him low, making it that much harder for Saji to top off his team.
And look at this positioning. Dark Archon just standing in his fellow the entire time. They're literally attacking into it and not caring. They're avoiding it intentionally. It's awesome to watch this. And they're just not even taking damage. They're intentionally avoiding it. They're doing a great job. There's the Infernal coming out for a little bit of stun, but they just haven't had any pressure. And they're still, again, sitting low HP, sitting at 50%. There is no Vendetta or Wings available, but they just have him low. There's the full stun onto Saji. I don't know how they're doing so much damage always. It must be Fabio's ability to swap between them. The wall, again, coming out from Dark Archon. Just so much pressure always. He just playing so defensively, having to fear the rogue off him, gets kidney shot. He does have that human now so we can get out of it. And Saji still has pretty good mana, but we're very early on here.
Yes, Splice initially just whittling down Panda Gaming, getting through those cooldowns, keeping them low. Eventually, Saji will run out of mana. But right now, Saji is actually ahead on mana, which is really, really nice for Panda Gaming. Doe down to around 40%. If you're using that Bloodlust, getting Swapsy down to 5% HP, the bubble is going to proc. So a nice amount of burst coming out from Panda Gaming there. Swapsy's now going to have to play a little bit more defensive. I think it's likely we see Swapsy and Botar using that pillar to line sight because they can't afford to be out into the open. But Swapsy's still a little bit low, down to 40% HP. Can Botar connect those heals onto him right now? Looks like he's going to be able to. He's positioned himself quite nicely. Fab's doing a lot of counter pressure though onto Dark Archon. Vendetta available. The axe toss out on the Fab though. He's going to get out of it. Use that Cloak of Shadows. A big swap over onto him. And now Dark Archon's in trouble. Saji does not have that Ironbark available for this Vendetta, so he's going to be taking quite a bit of damage.
And Dark Archon doesn't have any defensive lifts. He does have his wall. Just came back up. There's the Wings and Vendetta, though. They're going to be doing a ton of damage here. They could probably burst straight through it. Full Hodge onto Saji as well. They're just training Dark Archon. And they know he can go down here. There's wall available for Doe, so they don't want to go on him. And actually, the healing throughput from Saji comes out. And he's actually topping his team off. Meanwhile, no bubble for Swapsy. I don't think Doe has his Ascendance anymore, which is how Swapsy got so low in the first place. He popped in and bursted him straight down. They need to get that to happen again before bubble comes back up. But it's a shorter cooldown than Ascendance, so it's going to be hard for them to do that.
Yeah, they need to get a swap over on Fabs. He does not have that human trinket available anymore, but Dark Archon, I don't know if they're going to be able to turn around the pressure. Bloodlust is available for Doe. The Hodge going out on the Saji, though. Dark Archon, can he survive? Swapsy and Fabs on the full offensive right now, down to 5% HP. Can Saji heal through this damage? The Ironbreak connects, spamming out those heals. The offensive Cyclone going out onto Botar. They're trying to turn around the pressure right now. The Axe Toss out onto Swapsy. Now, can Swapsy survive the damage coming in from this Enhancement Shaman as well as this Demonology Warlock? Doe using that Bloodlust. The Hodge, though, going out onto Saji. Dark Archon still dangerously low. He's using that Sacrificial Pact. He's going to be able to survive, but Fabs has that Vendetta coming up in 15 seconds.
And they're both just always dying. There's a Cyclone onto Fabs, so once he comes out, I don't know how they're going to be able to survive. He's just always been low. They don't have any cooldowns left. Kidney Shot comes out. They're swapping back and forth, making sure both are always low, so Saji has a hard time. He has 1% mana again. He needs to be able to get a drink, but his Dark Archon has just been low. Oh, as he can't stop healing. Wings coming up in 20 seconds. Vendetta back up. They've just had pressure the entire time. It's unstoppable, it seems like.
Yeah, Saji is completely tapped on mana. The bash coming out. Adaptation is going to proc. Dark Archon now into the kidney shot. This could just be it. Splice could go up 3-0 on the series. Dark Archon gates away. Going to be preventing his death for a little bit. Doe also taking quite a bit of damage. Fabs trying to reconnect, trying to shut down Dark Archon the best he can. Vendetta coming out as well. Saji just has nothing left. How can he heal through this damage? The Iron Bark goes out onto Dark Archon. Can they keep him alive? Swapsy now has his bubble available, so he's going to be completely fine pushing in and getting aggressive. The Bloodlust comes out from Doe. They need to get this counter pressure out onto Swapsy. The clone coming out from Saji. He has nothing left. He has no mana for regrowth. I assume Dark Archon and Doe are both fully hotted, but that's really all they have left.
And there's the wings, and yes, he does get the finishing blow there. They're just always so low. I don't know how Saji is able to keep composure through this. It's just they're always so low. He has no mana. I don't even know what you cast at that point. It's probably just spamming Healing Touch in the background, and it's just not enough. And just the amount of pressure that Fops and Swapsy had was so scary. If you like being in a tournament before, I've had those situations where we're all so low, dampening's happening, and it's just so hard to recover. It's so nerve-wracking dealing with a team like this where they're just always on your neck. You want to get some damage off, but you're just too low to go on the offensive, get the fears on the healer, get stuns on the healer, and they just felt so far behind the entire time. So really rough game for them. That stuff like that really rattles you in the end.
Oh, it definitely does. And, you know, being a Demonology Warlock, you know, of course, Dark Archons does have that Soul Link available, but his pet was actually getting killed quite often. There was one moment where we watched him when he was at 5% health. He actually dropped the casting circle to get that pet back out, and that's actually what saved him during that exchange. You know, he lived just for a little while longer because having that Soul Link was what saved him.
Yeah, absolutely. Splice doing an incredible job, though, using that composition that sort of carried them through regionals, that Rhett Rogue Wrestler Druid composition. We saw that also at the North American regionals a little bit, but it seems like most people abandoned the comp after some nerfs came in. They're showing that it still works. Very commanding game coming out from Splice. They are the 2015 BlizzCon champions, and they're showing that they're still here to play, and they're still incredibly good.
They are. And after that great series, of course, we are going to let our next series, the players, set up. So we'll be back after this break.
I have witnessed our end. Demonic armies spilling over the horizon and onto our shores. Heed my warning. The Burning Legion has returned. Stronger, more determined than ever before, these demons seek to annihilate everything upon Azeroth. No single person can stand against the Legion alone.
And so you came to me.
I will deal with these intruders.
No, she wouldn't.
I knew we couldn't trust her!
In the end, death claims us all.
The Legion cannot be stopped.
Our time is short. Now go. But remember, should you fail, all worlds will burn.
Welcome to BlizzCon!
This is one of the coolest things you're ever going to see in your life.
We invented some brand new characters.
When we first did BlizzCon back in 2005, we had no idea what to expect.
Are we ready to begin the costume contest?
It's so much more than a game in a box.
Have a great BlizzCon!
The World of Warcraft Arena World Championship is sponsored in part by Intel, T-Mobile, NVIDIA, and Republic of Gamers.
Fail humanity again.
The first war began when Medivh, the last guardian of Tirith's Fall, opened the dark portal and unleashed the orcish horde upon Azeroth. While he paid for his actions with his life, Medivh's spirit could not rest. Returning to atone for his past, he guided a new generation of heroes against the Burning Legion. Now, he brings his wisdom and power to the Nexus, ready to take his place amongst legends. Medivh is a calculating ranged specialist who focuses on supporting his team with strong utility spells. Medivh's trait is Raven Form. Instead of mounting, Medivh transforms into a raven, allowing him to fly and see over terrain. While in Raven Form, Medivh is invulnerable and cannot be targeted. His first basic ability, Arcane Rift, sends a small magical shockwave along the ground, damaging all enemies in its path. If Arcane Rift hits an enemy hero, its cooldown is greatly reduced. Next up is Force of Will. Medivh grants an ally the Protected status, shielding them from all damage for a short period of time. Medivh's last basic ability is Portal. When cast, he places two linked portals onto the battleground, one at his location and the other one at the target point. Medivh and his teammates can travel between the portals at will. Medivh's first heroic ability is Polybomb. This spell turns an enemy hero into a flying sheep, silencing them and suppressing their attacks. Once the effect expires, it will spread to other enemy heroes within range. There's no limit to how many times Polybomb can chain between your opponents. Another lockdown option for Medivh is Leyline Seal. After a short windup, Medivh launches a slow-moving wave that travels in a straight line. Any enemy heroes caught in the spell's path will be trapped in stasis for a few crucial seconds. Medivh's greatest strength is his ability to set up amazing plays. At level 1, the Portal Mastery talent allows Medivh to control the placement of both his portals. Use this to set up incredible options for engaging and escaping the opposing team. Because Medivh's Raven Form is invulnerable, he can safely scout the enemy team while in flight. They will be unable to stop you from reporting everything you see back to your allies. A well-timed Force of Will can save an ally's life and turn the tide of battle. Watch your opponents closely and absorb the most damaging attacks directed at your team. Facing a team that likes to group up, Polybomb might be the choice for you. Wait for that key moment, then cast Polybomb on the target in the middle of the pack. Your opponents will be forced to spread out to avoid being polymorphed, allowing your team a chance to pick them off one at a time. Leyline Seal is a little riskier to use, but it has amazing setup potential. Use it to place closely gathered opponents in stasis, giving your team time to surround them. Enemies can dodge Leyline Seal if they see it coming, so cast it carefully to trap as many as possible. As the last guardian, Medivh guides his allies to victory by reading his enemies and controlling the flow of battle.
About the last series, we're actually going to replay that last map because due to a communication error, we actually selected the wrong map. So we are going to be playing Game 3 on Ruins of Lordaeron. And of course, that does mean that Panda Gaming does have a chance at coming back at this. However, that last map wasn't even close yet again, so it's going to be a scary moment for Panda Gaming. They do have another shot at it, but Splice has been dominating this series.
Yeah, I just don't know what they can do for strategy, really. I feel like this is Splice's game to lose. They have so much upfront damage. Every target's really hard to kill. If Botar and Swapsy decide to play safe, I just don't see how Dark Archon can get the damage off to really finish them off.
Yeah, it's a better map for them for sure. I was wondering why they picked that mode in the first place, because you'd think, hey, you're in a big map again. You just picked one. Why go back? So it makes more sense that they're on Ruins of Lorna. They're probably going to go for more quick kills here, because this is a very close map. You guys are going to be next to each other the entire time. So one problem with being close is Fabio's going to be able to swap back and forth a lot easier now. He's going to be able to just run over, put his dots up on one guy and back to the other. So I'm worried for them here, even on this new map.
Yeah, and they are going to be locked into those same compositions, of course, because those were locked in and confirmed. So I'd like to see a little play style difference, maybe, you know, play more offensive, you know, really, really land those big burst kills, because we really haven't seen much burst damage coming out of this comp for Panda Gaming when we know the burst potential is extremely high from seeing someone like Method NA play it.
Yeah, absolutely. And Ruins of Lordaeron is a map where there's not that much LOS option. So Dark Archon, like we were talking about, should be able to get those fears out onto Botar, get a little bit more damage out onto Swapsy when he finally can connect. And it's going to be harder for Swapsy to really run away. He's not going to have those big pillars he can run around. There is a tomb, but of course, they'll be able to just walk over it. Dark Archon, get off those casts, get off that burst. And I feel like this map is going to work out much better for them.
And I think their strategy really is to shut down the enhanced emo. One is sitting on the lock, making sure he kicks every hand of Gul'dan. He's making sure he kidney shots the casting circle. So Dark Archon is doing like half the damage that he wants to. Meanwhile, Doe is just under fire the entire time from the Ret Paladin. He's having to run away. So when you cut their pressure down like that, it's a lot easier to control their burst, because you're, instead of being at 80% when you take the damage, you're at 100% with defensives available.
Now, let's say Panda Gaming were to play this comp in absolutely ideal conditions, you know, best map possible, best talents, best, you know, playing every burst. How do you think it matches up against this comp overall?
I feel like it's really difficult for a Resto Druid to deal with the damage coming out from an Assassination Rogue and a Retribution Paladin. Eventually, he will just go Oom. The only real cooldowns he has available is that Ironbark, and it's hard when you have the Wings to deal with. You also have the Assassination Rogue Vendetta. It's just so much pressure that he's going to have to get out a lot of casts, and if he's casting a lot, he's going to go Oom quickly. But I do think the Enhancement Shaman and that Demonology Warlock do provide enough damage and enough burst for them to land a kill. It's just a matter of them setting it up.
Yeah, the problem really seems to be the Resto Druid. He's not able to heal through the damage, whereas the Holy Paladins earlier, they're bopping that Vendetta off. They're helping their teammates with Avenger Crusader to do damage to get the healing off without being CC'd. So it seems like a big difference to have that Holy Paladin here.
All right, so we're just letting these players have a few moments to set back up. Rich, what's going on down on the floor?
Thanks, Jared. Yeah, I think Doe is really going to be the player to watch in this match. He's the young guy. This is his first BlizzCon. He's also a student, but he has Dark Archon on his team, who's just a veteran. So he's been able to learn so much from him, and I think it's going to show going into this next game. Jared, back to you.
Thank you very much. Of course, the Knowledge Seeker Doe, you know, doing a great job playing that Enhanced Shaman, so we'll have to see, because he really needs to be the player to make those plays. He really needs to set up for his Demonology Warlock to land a giant burst at the same time. I'd like to see Dark Archon have better use of Thalkeels. Like, we saw him do one or two really good ones, but he really needs to set up, get as many pets out as possible, empower them along with a large timer pet like an Infernal, you know, make sure he has the biggest HP pool possible out of those pets before using Thalkeel into an implosion at the same time that they have Bloodlust running, and hopefully they can score a kill with it.
Yeah, we actually had a chance to sit down with these teams a little bit earlier on, and we asked them some questions, and one of the questions we asked is, like, who really is the leader on your team? And they all unanimously said Doe. He is the leader. He right now, you could see on the screen a little bit earlier, he was the Knowledge Seeker. He's a student right now, but he's also the one who sort of commands the battlefield. He comes up with these strategies that this team is using. So it's really cool to see these guys play and a little bit some of their different talent options that some of the North American and European teams haven't really thought of.
Yeah, and I'm worried for some of these new players, though. If when you're new to the tournament scene, some of my first tournaments, I was so scared when things like this happened, where we get so far behind, our strategy isn't working. We've played this a million times, but it's just not working out. This team is much better than we expected, and it just rattles you inside. So I'm worried that they're letting that happen to them. They're not getting their bursts off. They're not doing what they're normally supposed to do, where they burst together, and they're not coordinating as well as I'd like to see.
Now, do you think that's the main difference between a team like Method NA playing this comp and the team of Panda Gaming?
For sure. When I was watching Snuts or Chanimal play early on that Demonology Warlock, you could tell they were bursting with their teammate. They were ready, and they were stopping the enemy team from doing the damage that they were trying to deal. Meanwhile, I don't see Dark Archon doing the same for his team, peeling when they needed to. And I think stuff like that makes a huge difference to have our veterans out here who know to stop the enemy team when it's needed and to get that offensive pressure going when it's also needed.
I think it is a factor, but these guys, some of them have been to BlizzCon before. And I really feel like the biggest issue for them right now is that the only ability they have is to run that restoration druid. I feel like if they had that Holy Pally practiced and ready to go, they'd be able to make a much better showing here. It's really hard for Resto Druid to deal with that damage like we've been talking about. So it's going to be interesting to see what happens in this next game. Is there any other comps we saw Panda Gaming practicing in like the practice area a little bit earlier on?
Yeah, you know, I heard they had like Feral Shadow Priest. And maybe they had a Resto Shaman healing that, but normally you'd see the Holy Paladin coming in. I saw Method practicing that earlier as well, spoilers. But I think that comp is really good in general. I'm surprised they aren't trying new things because, you know, they're already locked into this, so they have to win this game. But if they did win, they have to come up with something new. This is not working. Maybe they need to get their things together, get the burst down, because I know when he popped Ascendance one time, he was able to get the Rep Paladin from 80% to zero, and that's what you want to see. You want to get that burst together, but they weren't able to do it outside of Ascendance, and I feel like it was just Fob shutting them down with the Kidney Shot and stuff, and they need to work around that better.
Yeah, let's talk about Splice a little bit right now. This is one of the only teams in the tournament that intentionally has a three-player roster. They multi-class a lot, and one of the really interesting things to me is a lot of these guys on this team, Fabs and Swapsy, they play the same class. Like, two of them play Warlock, two of them play Shaman. That really just shows the versatility of these players and how confident they are. Usually you just have someone who mostly plays Warlock, and that's your Warlock on the team, or someone who usually plays Mage, and that's your Mage on the team. These guys, everyone plays everything, and it's just really impressive to watch all the different comps that they have. Although, to be fair, in this European regional and in the European regionals and this tournament, we've only exclusively seen them on this Rhett Rogue Druid, despite them practicing so many other comps as well.
Yeah, and I'm not surprised to see this coming after them. They're so good at these three specs, and I've seen Botar swap around from different classes. I've seen Swapsy do the same, and having Fabio in the roster, he's normally the Warlock, but he picked up Rogue knowing it was so good, and he's, like, to me, one of the better rogues here. He's doing so well in it. The amount of damage he's dealing is so impressive, and that to me is one of the key things about being a good assassination runner, is just bouncing between targets, getting your dots up on everything, making sure you're doing optimal damage, and that is not easy.
Yeah, I want to talk to Method EU as well as Northern Gaming Blue. They gave us a little bit of insight on how Splice works. These guys practice all day. When they aren't practicing, they're constantly leveling up different characters, practicing different specializations. Not only that, but they're always watching to see what the other teams are doing. What are you guys practicing? And they always have that in the back of their mind, always coming up with different ideas. And I think that's why these guys are so consistent and do such a good job in tournaments.
And when you have a three-man roster like this, when you're playing with your entire team. You don't need the other person to swap in and out, try different comps. They're playing a lot of the same thing, and that's why they're so good at things like Rhett Rogue.
And that is a big deal with having three versus four. You kind of build that team synergy. When you have somebody that's your fourth man on your team that you don't always utilize constantly, it means, yeah, do you really want to spend that much practice time with the fourth person versus your main three? And it's possible that, like, a team such as Splice has a few comps that they're extremely good at. Now, if you add a fourth man, and maybe they can play those one or two specs to kind of round out, do you spend 90% of your time playing your main three and only let the fourth man play 10%? Maybe you have communication breakdowns for that. So sticking to your guns and playing the comps that are really great, you know, Splice is doing a great job with three members on their team.
Yep, and they're very consistent. And like we talked about, these guys are the former BlizzCon champions. And one thing that I found really interesting, the composition that they won with last year was that Enhancement Shaman, that Arms Warrior, and that Restoration Druid, what we call Turbo Cleave. Now they're running something that actually stylistically is very similar. It has a lot of upfront damage, a lot of burst potential, but also very tanky. So they can use some of that coordination and strategies that they built running that Turbo Cleave, now put it into this Rhett Rogue Druid composition, and they play very similarly, surprisingly.
Yeah, and we'll have to see. You know, it's interesting to see the playstyle difference of the two druids. We see them both pushing up four cyclones pretty often, kind of faking each other out. You know, there was a couple times when Saji kind of chased Botar off of his pillar just by acting like he was going to cast a cyclone on him, but he actually landed some onto to Swapsy and Fabs at that point. So it was a great play out of him at that point. Just to give you an idea, again, the big difference talent-wise that I saw between Botar and Saji is going to be that Prosperity. So he does have Swift Men with two charges, but he's not going to have the Cenarion Ward. Of course, the big difference there is Cenarion Ward, since it has a 30-second cooldown, it is a pretty big heal. And so he can use that because they know that the team of Panda Gaming is going to focus on one target. You know, instead of being able to spread out your HOTS, you know, Prosperity might do a better job at that since you can Swift Men two different targets. So we'll have to see if that can make a difference, you know, just from the playstyle between the two. And then Saji, because they did go Alliance, he is playing Adaptation instead of Relentless. And of course, Botar is playing Relentless.
Yeah, I was going to actually ask you, Rodney, how do you feel like that Relentless choice is working out for Saji over traditionally playing that Relentless talent?
It's weird. I've seen Adaptation come out when you're fighting things like Holy Paladins who have that like 30-second cooldown to a minute cooldown Hodge, and a lot of the time you're breaking a lot of these stuns, and if you're not getting CC out of that, which this team doesn't really have that much CC for him, it's working out well for him. The thing is with Saji, he's playing out of his mind healing-wise. He's getting CC on the enemy team. He's doing a ton of healing. He's healing with no mana sometimes, which is incredible in the first place, but he just isn't able to keep up because I feel like his class is hurting him here. He maybe needs to swap to that Paladin, but you know, he's already locked into that Resto Druid for this game, and we're going to have to see how that goes.
Yeah, one thing I like that Fabs is doing in this match is he's opening up onto Doe, getting out as much of damage as possible, and then he's swapping immediately over onto Dark Archon, and he's using that Vendetta. That way, it's a really hard decision for Saji. Does he use the Ironbark on the Vendetta, or does he use it on Doe, who's already low? And those kind of decisions and that sort of split pressure coming up from Fabs and Swapsy is really what's making it so difficult for Saji to actually get out that healing.
Now, if you're trying to follow along, the big burst cooldowns, you're going to see the white icon all the way on the right for the Warlock. That's Curse of Fragility, 20% damage. The one on the far left is Thalkeel's Consumption, which is the artifact ability. So when those two go on cooldown, that's normally when they're going to be setting up their burst.
And here we go. Game starting. Fabs already using Vendetta onto Dark Archon. Going to be shutting him down as much as possible, using the Kidney Shot to stop some of his damage. Botar trying to get CC out onto the enemy healer. And always Saji and Botar always going for clones on each other, but it's hard when one of them has the Adaptation Trinket to break out. Again, Fabs just training Dark Archon with that Vendetta. Wings again on Swapsy, and Doe always having to kite away from Swapsy, never able to toe-to-toe him.
I don't know if I like this positioning coming out from Dark Archon. He's playing a little bit safe, playing back in the room, but that means he can't get that CC out onto Botar. He can't get those casts out. Swapsy getting cloned up there by Saji. The Kidney Shot going out onto Dark Archon as well. Both Dark Archon and Doe using those offensive cooldowns, not really able to force anything. Botar still has that Ironbark available if he needs it as well. So sort of the first offensive pressure coming out from Panda Gaming, not working out too well for them. Splice really didn't have to use too much in that exchange.
Yeah, and that was the 3-minute cooldown ascendance from Doe where he was just hitting nobody, getting kited away. He did no damage with that. That was where he got bubble last time, and this time it's leading to nothing. So really bad start for him trying to get damage out. He's always getting kited from his target, and whenever he does connect with his target, he's always taking a ton of damage. So just rough game overall for Doe and Dark Archon, who just keeps getting CC'd. He just gets bashed. He's trying to get a clone. I believe that got interrupted, so good job on him to keep it going.
Yeah, absolutely. Botar pushing away, getting swapped to by Doe there, but now Doe trying to reconnect out onto Swapsy. Fabs having that Vendetta coming up in around 10 seconds. A Kidney Shot going out onto Dark Archon. He is going to break out of that with that human racial, that trinket for stun. So he doesn't have that available. The next Kidney Shot should sit full. Luckily for him, he is playing that Relentless as well. The Fabs wants to get aggressive with that Vendetta as soon as possible. The Groat going out onto Dark Archon. Going to be using that Sacrificial Pact as well. Fabs still just sitting on that Vendetta, finally going to be using it with that Kidney Shot under Dark Archon.
And he gets immediately cloned on that Vendetta. That really stinks, but it's going to be active for a pretty long time, so he's going to get more damage out of it, and he's going to force Saji to use more mana. Last time and the game before, he had Saji go out of mana, and that was their final way to kill it. Saji actually getting a bash into clone onto Botar. This is their chance to do some damage. Swapsy dropping to half. Meanwhile, Doe still standing at half. It's so hard for him to connect to his target because Fobs back on him again, Kidney Shotting him instead, really just swapping back and forth as usual, stopping their damage, and he's just doing so much. He's going to get back on the Warlock, kick the Shadow Ball. He gets bashed through. They're just stopping them on all of their burst attempts.
Yeah, the mana is looking very good for both druids right now, but Saji just really doesn't have the heals to keep Dark Archon up, finally getting that huge heal out. Botar as well using that Ironbark, so he's not going to have that available the next time Doe and Dark Archon decide to get aggressive. But yeah, Saji finally able to stabilize his team's HP for now. Swapsy does have that Avenging Wrath up to do that additional damage, but big burst going out onto Swapsy. Dips down to 20% HP, catches a huge heal from Botar there. He should be fine. The Avenging Wrath's going to come out. He wants to get aggressive out onto Doe. Doe down to around 40% HP. Saji sitting on that Ironbark right now, deciding not to use it. Putting that bash out actually onto Botar. If he can follow it up with that Cyclone, they might be able to get some pressure out onto Swapsy. Swapsy just doing such an incredible job right now. Line of sighting with those wings, topping himself off. And Doe now taking quite a bit of damage. Fabs does have him fully loaded up with those bleeds. Vendetta is up in 10 seconds. That wasn't even Vendetta, and Saji already having to use that Ironbark.
And he does not have Adaptation available right now. He gets Hodge, and he does. This gets Scale Trouble, but he actually gets a huge heal off on the Doe before that. He's able to top him off before that Vendetta is used. So great job on him. He didn't have Wall, so he would have spelled Trouble there. There's a bash on the Saji into a Cyclone. He does get it off. They're trying to get big damage on the Doe. He's sitting at 10%. He gates away. He's just Live Lord over here. He's running away. They're swapping to Dark Archon, it looks like, for now. And Fabio's trying to get there. He goes over and kicks Dark Archon. Darkrai gets the dots up and back onto Doe. He's sitting at 10% still. Vendetta is active. He needs to get to him to get some damage off, but he's getting knocked down. And finally, he does connect. He's getting damage off 10% HP. Is he going to survive? And Saji just, again, doing God's work, getting heals off, casting Rigo's into him, Kidney Shot into him. Hodge, adaptation's out. Is it enough, though? And no, it is not. He pops his lesson, goes down immediately after.
Yep, and that is going to do it. Splice is going to take that game on Runes of Lordaeron, going up 3-0 in the series, closing it out, and we're going to have to see Panda Gaming play another day.
Yeah, and great job by Splice. You know, that was a really commanding win again on that map. You know, a lot of damage coming out from both Fabs and Swapsy, about equal. You know, you can see 28 million from Fabs and about 27 million from Swapsy. So a lot of damage coming out. I do like the independent wings from Swapsy. It wasn't lined up with the Vendetta, but they just had so much offensive pressure already. They just wanted to keep it rolling throughout the entire.
Yeah, I think it's a really smart strategy. Saji, of course, having to respond to those cooldowns with Ironbark, and then eventually just doesn't have Ironbarks anymore to deal with that incoming pressure. And really just such an incredible job from Splice with that composition, just really sticking to their guns. And it's going to be interesting to see if they continue to run this composition or if this is something they specifically had in store for Panda Gaming.
Yeah, and thinking about the next matchup we're going to see with that team, they're going to fight Method NA, who's also running the same composition. I'm wondering if they're going to run it into that, or if they think that seems like a total counter comp, because Doe, if you looked at his damage done, he did half the damage of everyone else in the arena, and it's because he was getting locked down, he couldn't get his burst off, and he was just always so low to where he wanted to heal himself instead of getting damage off.
Yeah, the Ascendance you called out at the beginning, I think that's where everything went wrong. He really blew that 3-minute cooldown to try to chase the Druid, and by the time that Botar saw this happening, he was already kiting all the way on the opposite side. You were saying that that of course Dark Archon was kind of sitting back in the in their starting room. When he hit Ascendance, Botar was already in the enemy's starting room, so you can imagine how far that is away. But of course we have Richard standing by with Fabs from Splice.
I'm here with Fabs, two-time BlizzCon champion and the winner of that previous series. Now, everyone is talking about how you play Assassination Rogue a lot like an Affliction Warlock. Do you think that gives you the upper hand while playing that specialization?
Well, Assassination is kind of the Affliction Warlock of Legion, because Envenom does really low damage, and Rapture is like your main damage. So you want to like spread around on everyone and try to get the most possible advantage from Venom Rush and your energy regeneration. So yeah, I feel like the way Asarog has to be played is like spreading and playing Affliction Lock, basically.
So you've been with your current team for such a long time, so I'm sure you guys have developed quite a rapport. How do you feel that that actually affects you while you're playing these series?
Well, I don't know. This is the second year we play together. I don't think it's that long. This like teams that play longer together, but I mean, we still like know how to get into games. Like the way we prepare is like always the same routine, so yeah, that's an advantage. But I mean, beside that, we're like fine.
Yeah. You guys are kind of the team to beat going into this tournament. Do you feel like that gives you a little bit of an edge, or do you think it is a lot of pressure?
Well, I don't think it gives an edge and doesn't like put us pressure, because this is like our fourth BlizzCon for all of us, and we're the BlizzCon champions of last year, and every team here is respecting everyone, because every team has actually a chance to get to the final. So I don't think it's like pressure or advantage, it's just like every team can beat us, so we just play our best every time.
Even with two BlizzCons under his belt, respecting all of the possibilities throughout the tournament. Jared, back to you.
All right, thank you very much, Rich. I really like the answer to that question where they are saying every team has a chance at it. Unfortunately, since Panda Gaming did lose 3-0 to Splice, we're not going to see them for the rest of the day. And of course, the next time you'll see Panda Gaming will be at BlizzCon.
And Splice will actually be moving up and playing against Method NA next. I do believe
that's our next game.
Yeah.
Ooh. Yeah.
So that'll be exciting to see sort of the powerhouses coming up from North America as well as Europe and see how they stack up against each other.
All right. And speaking of next game, like we said, Method NA versus Splice. This is a huge match. Don't go anywhere. We're going to let the players set up and we'll be right back.